Our first candidate is Doug Edge. Oh, I'm sorry, I forgot to mention Jan Walczak cannot be here. She has a former or a prior community event that she has to be at, so she couldn't be here. And Scott Thorson will be a little late, so he'll be our last candidate.
All right, well, my name is Doug Edge. My wife here is Annette. I've been in the city 18 years. I moved here back then after the military. I remember as a child, I lived over by the ball fields, and I just to this day remember that slide over there and playing in the parks, and I'd always loved it, wanted to come here. It's a great town, great location, all that. But so prior to that, I grew up in the east side, went to Harvard High School. Growing up, didn't really know where I was going. My mother was pretty sick at the time, and I always wanted to go to the military. And she died in 88, 1989. Prior to her dying, I was interested in real estate. I got my real estate license. I never actually did anything with it. You know, let's face it, it takes money to get going. So that was my chance after she died to go into the military. So I joined the Navy. I stationed on the USS Nimitz. It's an aircraft carrier. And I was in the Persian Gulf. I was an aircraft firefighter. And I enjoyed that a lot. I came back out of that. I got my EMT certificate to get out of the St. Paul Fire Department, which it was my dream job. And there were some issues there I didn't get on. I was fifth on the list. And still didn't get on. And so that was one big introduction to government, what I thought of it. after that, I worked for a family business, Mike and Phillips Sweeping. My grandfather started that years ago. And had another thing there. It really got me interested in politics, watching the business, the issues they went through and all that. So I worked over there prior to going to the military. Then after the military, I worked for my brother who runs it now. And then through experience there, plowing and street sweeping and hauling and those construction type things. I worked with all sorts of cities around the area, state jobs, Highway 94, all these different things. Got to learn about that. Then I applied for the city of Maplewood. I started there in 1994. So I guess as far as council, my background would be, really knowing, understanding the workings of a city, the utility side of it, the streets and all that. So I have a good understanding of what it takes to keep a city together. And I can, from one of my old bosses, he always said, you see the things above ground, no one thinks of them, the stuff below ground, which is a lot of money, a lot of maintenance and issues that go into that. So, I have a good background in public works and all that. I guess what really got me going, obviously, let's face it, we all have our issues and living in the city here. Back when I first moved in, there was some flooding going on in the area, and I went to talk to the mayor and discuss that, and he walked away from me. I didn't appreciate that much. So then over the years, may or may not know, we had a cat issue going on, and the way I was treated, my wife, we're not, again, after the meeting, I'd love to tell anybody everything that went on, but it really showed me what's going on in this town. We have a beautiful town, it's a great location, we need to sell that, and just the way things were handled, again, with the bars and some other situations, it's got to change. There is no communication here, you cannot treat people the way we were treated. I know there's a gentleman, I think he lives on 2nd Street, that's been flooding down there. And he just seems to get blown off. Nobody wants to fix the problem. Well, we need to communicate. I guess that's my big concern, with the city. And we had a good talk with Wally just now, and he explained some of one of my concerns was 36. There's no ramps going there, and I just feel like, I asked him, how would Maplewood be if we didn't have an exit on White Bear Avenue, or Woodbury if there was an exit on Radio Drive? I really think that hurt our city. It really hurt our downtown area. And, he explained it, and he gave a good explanation, but I still think we could have done better. And then you have the bar issue going on, and the way that, I understand the issue, he explained some of it. It's just not being handled well. I don't agree with that. And one of the big things that really got me running is, again, the communication, but the way our policing in the city is going, some major issues. The handling with Mrs. Crittenden, Officer Crittenden's wife, if any of you have seen the video, it's amazing how she was treated by our chief of police. And honestly, if I get on, I would like to have him come forward and answer for the way he treated her. And I would like an apology from the council, well, from not the council, but from the city manager and from the mayor and the chief of police. And another big issue is getting business into the downtown area. And how do we do that? I think, first of all, this city has a bad reputation. You know I got my issues, and I try to put that aside, and I ask people wherever I go, what do you think of North St. Paul? And I got to tell you, we have a bad reputation here.
For what?
The harassment by our police department. They don't even want to come down here. And then other things. You know, we've lost Max down here. What's down here? So we really got to, I think, work on our reputation. You know, whether it's deserved or not, start asking around. I think you'll understand it. You'll see what I'm talking about. And another big concern is obviously business, which means we get a lot of state aid money. And I'm concerned with the elderly people on fixed incomes. What's going to happen to them if our taxes go up, if the state cuts us off? You know, those are the types of issues I want to work with, get on the planning commission, things like that, to understand how do we get business down here. And again, I think first we start with our reputation. And we got to have people answer for, you know, the citizens got to answer. You get a ticket, you do something, you get a ticket, you got to answer. Our leaders need to start answering for themselves. The meeting last week, there was an attorney wanted to speak for the bars. He showed up, I think a minute, 30 seconds, 2 minutes to for him to speak. Would have been great. We need to get information out there. I understand they couldn't vote on it, I get that, but we gotta let people speak around here. And if I'm the council, I'll tell you what, I'm gonna stand up and I'm gonna let the mayor know. I don't, if I have to make a scene, whatever it is, voices will be heard around here. I may not agree with you if you come to me, but you will be heard, I will get back to you, and I will try to find an answer. You know, I'll be honest, I don't know all the things about a government and city. That's why I expect people like yourselves out there, if you have an issue that really concerns you, you need to call me, you need to let me know and educate me on that issue. If it's with schools or whatever it is, you know, it's your job too as a citizen to educate your leaders. But I'll be there. I guess my big thing is I'll be a voice for you. You know, I'm not going to sit back and let things happen. And if you got questions, issues, you're being harassed, anything. You know, and again, I hate to, you know, go into all the negative things because this is such a beautiful city. I'd like to see crazy days come back. I think that's the way we sell our city. You know, let's face it, other cities, they have these things. You get there, you see their city, how they've changed. There have been a lot of good changes in the city. The downtown area is starting to really come to life. And you know, how do we get people down there to see it? It's by having things like Crazy Days, the Friday night things. You know, when I look at our leaders, the mayor and them, I gotta tell you, I've been here 18 years, I've never seen them downtown other than the parade. Why aren't they down there? I've seen Candy down there, haven't seen the mayor. Where's he at? How can you say you work for a city or you love your city and you don't even, you're never around to talk to the people down there? I would like to get the back, you know, maybe I'm a little out there, but you know, maybe, why aren't the police walking around greeting people, meeting them? That's a perfect opportunity for them to get to know them. My personal opinion is because they're gonna give you a ticket later on, they don't wanna get to know you. I want a city where the police get to know the people, where you can walk up to them. You know, years ago when I first moved in, if they drove down the road, they'd wave to you, they'd slow down and stop and talk to you. They don't do it anymore. And again, that Friday night thing with the cars is a terrific thing to sell the city. You know, it's an opportunity, instead of sitting against their cars, get out and talk to people. You know, I guess that's what I'm all about, communicating.
Doug, oh. First question. Doug, first question we have. Can you provide us with two suggestions of how you would attract new business to North St. Paul?
Well, again, I'll go back to my other thing. You're trying to change your reputation. How do we do that? You know, I think we gotta re-educate our police. I really think are a big problem. We gotta educate them. And I don't wanna put them all in the same category. I think it's just a handful. and I think it starts with the chief. We need to be professional, and again, like I said, treat people, because, you know, again, this kid that's got the house down here, he's flooding out. What happens? He's a young guy, he has a lot of friends looking for homes. Now, if he doesn't get taken care of, you know, and dealt with properly, professionally, what's going to happen? He's not going to tell his friends to move here. Our issue with the cat, you know, if you agree or not agree, it's the way it was handled. You know, bad publicity. We can't have bad publicity. The thing with the bars could have been handled a lot better. That bad publicity, you know, people looking to move to North saying, well, hey, I don't want to go there. Why would I go there? And whenever these negative things happen, they affect, you know, how people think. When they're wise, they're going to move to Oakdale. They're going to move somewhere else. Like I said, again, we have so much to sell here. We have great parks, great location, you know, getting real estate, location. That's the key. We have all that. We got to sell it. I don't know if it means commercials, whatever. You're crazy. If there's another, that's how you sell your city, you know? And again, why would people want to go to the city when the mayor and their own leaders don't even want to go to it? We got to get them down there, get them involved as council people. We got to get involved and get down there.
Okay, thank you. The second question is, describe your goals and priorities if elected to the city council.
Again, my goals are to be your voice. Do you have an issue? Because I know, one thing I know working with Public Works, people always come to us on the street and I'm saying, you know, you need to call engineering, you need to call, you. Hey, they don't get back to us. They don't tell us anything. So if you tell somebody, you know, it's kind of funny because a little can go a long way. If you get back to somebody, like somebody asks me a question, the next day I'll drive out to their house, knock on their door and let them know. You know, I mean, so as a council person, you know, if you say you're gonna do something, do it. If somebody calls you and you don't have the answer, just be honest. Hey, I don't have it. I'll find it for you. You know, or what's your recommendation? If you've got an issue with the person, instead of arguing, say, how do you want to solve? How do you see this solved? What do you see the answer here? And if you can provide that or if you can't, let them know. Just be honest with people. Give them a voice. Not like the mayor shutting them down, hitting the gavel, not letting them speak. You got to let people speak.
Thank you, Doug.
Thank you.
Next round.
Hopefully you guys grabbed one or I got you one of these, but it has a lot of the information that you probably are looking for, kind of where I, you know, what I'm doing, what I come from, who I am. So in brief, I hope you guys can hear me. I'm kind of a loud talker as it is, so I apologize for that.
The mic's on.
I know, but we really want people to hear when they leave here, and if I talk into a mic. My name is Eric Ekstrand. You know, the stats are married, 4 boys, been involved in the community since I moved here, got forced by my wife to be a scout leader, found out I actually kind of enjoyed it, got forced to be a coach, actually kind of found out I enjoyed it. You know, I was did those kinds of things, volunteered at the school, you know, do the kind of things that you do as a parent, right? And as a member of the community, you know, one of those people that it's hard to have somebody, you know, I need a volunteer, and, you know, everybody else has, you know, got their hands glued to their side, and out of nowhere, your hand's going up, and you're, another thing on my plate. I'd have a contingent here, but they're at football, so my wife is chauffeuring them around, and if she wasn't doing it, I'd be doing it. You know, I guess the synopsis of my life is I work for an evil healthcare company in Minnesota, so don't hate me for that, but you know, it's a job. I work in the IT side, so I don't make policy. I'm a computer nerd by trade. I actually manage a team of professionals within my group. We're network engineers, and so we build networks, which I won't bore you with the details behind that, but needless to say, you know, part of my responsibilities is to work with business people. My responsibilities is to deal with conflict, to deal with challenges, to make projects work, make sure my team is doing what they're supposed to be doing, make sure that they're coming in on time and on budget, and if there's issues that I step in and I resolve them. All my new hires that I bring in, I always tell them, first thing I tell them off the bat, you know, first of all, I jokingly say, you know, I'm not just here for looks, I'm actually here to provide a function, and that is, my job is to help you do your job better. So if you're running into roadblocks, or you're having issues, or you're having problems, that's where you need to come and get me. If you don't come and get me, that's partially your problem. Okay, I'm working with people that, you know, college degrees, they've been in the industry for some cases 15, 20 years. If they're afraid to come to me and say, hey, I need help, well, that's a problem with you. Now the next thing is, you come to me for help, I need to help you. Because if I don't help you, I'm not doing my job. Because then my boss gets on my case and says, why aren't you doing your job? So the point that I'm trying to make is that I'm already in that mode. You know, I'm already in that, hey, we've got a problem, and we can't just let it go. We got to find the solution. I'm already in the mode of, hey, we only have a finite amount of money, but we still got to do this. You know, a lot of the stuff I do in my industry is the business goes out and sells something, and then they come to us and say, oh, by the way, we sold this, now build it. And we have to go, oh, crap. And we turn around and we have to build it in the time allotted and the amount allotted. So if you take the parallels to that and what we have to deal with in the city, there's a lot of parallels to that. You know, city has a budget, there's a finite amount of money, you don't get more. Unfortunately, in government, they can get more. That's by taxing us. So if they go over budget, we're on the hook for it. And I'm not a huge fan of that. Again, I come from a business world that says you got to live within the budget or else you're not doing your job. And I kind of see the city as that. If the city is not living within their budget, they're not doing their job. Now, the other aspect of my role is I have to work with different types of people. I have to work with people who are business-minded and they're thinking about the bottom line and I got to get this product out there. I'm dealing with technology people. You know, they want to talk ones and zeros. I got to talk to both of them. All right, I got to be able to be that mediator between the two. And again, if you draw the parallels between what you're looking for in a city council member, we have to be the mediator between you and the city, not the roadblock between you and the city, or defer. I always tell my people when I work, I always say, you know, if I don't know the answer, I'm going to at least get you to the person that does. And 9 times out of 10, I tell them, if you don't get the answer, let me know. And we'll figure out something else. That's what you should be doing as a city council member, as a mayor, as a staff. I don't care who you are. You should be saying, hey, how do I make this person happy with me? I didn't know if you're waving here. Raising your fly. So that's kind of how I see, you know, your role in any kind of leadership position. You should not be passing the buck. You should be saying, hey, how do I resolve this issue? How do I fix this problem? And I think I have skills in that area with the leadership roles that I've held within the community as a coach and in my professional life. I think I have those skills. I think I can sit down at a table. I talked to a council member a few weeks ago, and that person said it was as simple as bringing these people to the table and getting them to talk to each other. And unfortunately, that's sometimes the way things should be done. But there's this back and forth, you know, communication. I mean, Greg, right?
Doug,
I'm sorry. I told somebody I'm horrible with names. I'll get it figured out. You know, it's as simple as bringing people to the table and communicating. And, you know, we see that in Maplewood, and we're seeing it in North St. Paul. You know, when you get gaveled down by the mayor because you want to say something that might be controversial, I don't know if that's a good way to handle customer service, right? You got elected. You know, you're kind of at the will of the people. You're going to get fired if you're not doing a good job, right? You're not going to get reelected. And frankly, I don't think you should look at this job as a career choice. I mean, this is not a advance my career, I want to be whatever. This should be a, hey, I'm serving the community. I see a problem, how can I fix it? And can I help fix it? So the question is, and that's the question that you guys are going to get faced. I know I'm going to vote for myself. I think my wife will. All right, I'm hoping, my neighbors, things like that. But that's the choice you guys have. You know, you got 6 candidates sitting up here. You got a couple that have been in that position before or are in that position. You got newbies like us who've, you know, been around the block or ran in the past for other things. You got to decide who's going to best represent me, and are they full of bull? Are they giving me a line? Are they truthful or are they not? The way I look at it, I'm running purely for the fact that I feel like I can help. I personally think I can help and do something to fix the issues that we have. Communication's a big issue. We have a lack of it. I think we need to challenge where challenge needs to be done. We should not be blindly answering yes to everything, you know? Now, there's a lot of stuff that happens behind the scenes. There's a lot of backdoor negotiations. There's a lot of office conversations that we're not privy to. And I understand that. And I'm not saying that I know all the things that are going on behind the scenes. But I know what I see. And I know what I see in the community. And that's what everyone else is seeing. And if they don't know what's happening behind the scenes, then they're under the same impression probably that I am. When they see the empty homes and the foreclosed properties and the... Am I good on time? Okay. I see the hands go up and I get nervous. Kind of like, whoop, never mind. You know, I see the empty properties. I see the properties the city has paid to clear in hopes to bring businesses into the city, and yet they're still cleared, they're still empty, and we don't have prospects. So the question is what's being done today working? And if it's not, then maybe we need a change. If you think things are going to get better, by all means, do what you guys feel you need to do. I'm a tech nerd. I have a website up. I've been posting stuff here and there. I posted an opinion on how the city council meeting went the other day. Happy to post other things because that's an easy way for me to communicate. So on the personal side, am I okay? I'm sorry. I'm kind of rambling, so I apologize if you guys aren't getting anything out of this. But, you know, I'm originally from New Jersey. Both my parents are from Minnesota. My dad was in the Army, so I'm an Army brat. I was born in New Jersey, lived out there most of my life, and then moved back here in my adult years and to be closer to my family. And, you know, my first exposure to North St. Paul was riding around with my then girlfriend, now wife, and driving through North St. Paul and seeing the ice cube lights. And, you know, because it was winter and the lights were out, and both of us thought that's the coolest thing. And when we were living in Apple Valley, we found the house that we're living in now, not realizing how much work we were going to have to put into it, and still putting into it. But we said, that's the house that we want to raise our family in. And that's where we are right now. And that's why I'm here, because I want other families to look online, find a house in North St. Paul, and say, that's the house I want to raise my family in.
Thanks, Erica. Currently, we have numerous commissions and committees within the city. Which one interests you the most?
Planning Commission, definitely. Just to help drive the direction of things. Again, I think my skill set fits into there.
That goes along with my next question,
okay.
Which is gonna be, what is your vision for the city in the next 4 years?
Shining towers, or no. You know, and I think it's a good question. I appreciate that one, because here's the reason why. I hear, and again, you don't know what's truth and what's not half the time, but you hear people don't want to change the way North St. Paul is. I totally agree, right? But we're also in 2012, right? We've got to do something to change. We've got some new buildings that are partially vacant downtown in that 7th Avenue Road. You know, we've got an empty spot where the City Hall used to be. Do I want to see what makes North St. Paul get completely ripped out and changed? Absolutely not. Stillwater has managed to keep its old world charm, but still bring in businesses and bring in tax dollars and money that support that community. Why can't we do that here? Well, we don't have a highway running right in the middle through us right now. And unfortunately, we kind of got cut off, which doesn't help matters, but that's, so what is my vision? We need to bring businesses in. We need to encourage them. I know there's a business, hopefully they don't yell at me for pointing them out, North St. Paul Auto. I talked to them not too long ago. I get my car fixed there, by the way. I talked to those guys, and they said, you know what, when we came here, we wanted to open up an auto shop. We said, great. They made us sell gas. Now, they're being forced to sell gas by the city, because the city wants them to sell. They're an automotive place. Why do they need to sell gas? But because that was a stipulation made by the city manager and the city council by proxy, they're selling gas at $4 a gallon, which isn't too far from the way it is right now, but why? You know, I talk to other people. I don't hear positive things when they have to interact with the city, all right? I will say one positive thing. When I had to have my furnace put in, the inspector came out, no problems, everything went great. I'm thrilled about that, because that's a thing, paranoid. But I don't hear a lot of positives from that perspective, and I think that's got to change. Do I know all the different details of it? No. I'm not going to stand here and say I do. But I am going to say we got to do better about talking about why things are happening the way they are. And if we don't, we're going to continue to have what we have. Sorry.
Thanks, Eric.
Is that it?
No, thank you.
All right.
Thank you. Our next candidate is probably already well known, Dave Zick.
Thank you. I appreciate the opportunity to come. I'm a lifelong resident of the city. I've lived here 65 plus years, excuse me, fourth generation in this city. My great-grandfather, my grandfather, my parents, myself, now my daughter and her family also live in North St. Paul, so actually we've had five generations. It's a great community. It's a fantastic community. We all have we got some problems. There's no doubt about it. I guess I'm one of the few, I think, that started school and graduated in the same building from North St. Paul, so that gives you an idea how far back that was. My wife is a graduate of North, my children are graduates of North. Of course, when I graduated, I didn't have much choices. A lot of you people didn't, I know. You had the military service staring at you. So I wound up with 33 years in the service, both active Air Force and Air National Guard, with great career. Then the city gave me an opportunity to get on the fire department. I was a volunteer firefighter. Well, I served on the fire department for 33 years also, kind of a coincidence. I was a paid on call volunteer, as they are now, for 20 years, and I had the great privilege in the last 13 years being the chief of the fire department in the city of North St. Paul. This gave me an opportunity to work with everybody in the city. It did. The city's very fortunate with the people they do have. Not everybody's perfect, but they work hard. They work very hard. You look at our public works staff, one of the smallest ones around, and the work they accomplish. Our city staff, it's not huge. They accomplish a lot of work. Our infrastructure is bad. There's no knocking it. This is an old community that's been pointed out, well over 100 years old. It's going to cost us money to repair it. I know that. It's got to be phased in, stepped in. My major concern is, get me wrong, I know we got to get business in this town, we've got to do some cleanup, but I don't want to lose sight of the 11,000 plus residents of this city that we also have to look out for, not just 7th Avenue. When I retired in 2001 from the fire department, I retired in July, well, September that year, we all know what happened. I came back as emergency management coordinator for the city. So I've been heavily involved in that, and it's kept me abreast of what's going on in the city. I have worked with, like I said, with the emergency management, trying to get us prepared in the event of a disaster we hope never happens. City staff has been really cooperative with this, so has Public Works. I'm not good at this, so you gotta bear with me here. Like I say, I love this community. We got a ways to go. We're going to make it go. I've been on the Neighborhood Stabilization Task Force for 8 years. I've also now served on the Police Commission. My wife and I manage a local food shelf, which we have for 9 years. I got stuck with president of the board because I missed a meeting. That's how I got that one. We also organize the Fair for All Express, if you're familiar with that, down at the community center. These are all good things for our community. The food shelf is, it's a shame that we do have to have it because it means that people do need help, but we're here to help. This community of North St. Paul donates 70% plus to that food shelf, which takes care of Oakdale and North St. Paul. We used to take care of Maplewood, we just couldn't anymore. So now they set up their own, but the generosity of this community is great. I mean, I hear a lot of negative talk about this and that. it's still a great, great community to live in. It is. I tell you what, I keep it short, and that's going to be it.
Okay. Thank you, Dave. First question. When you decided to run for council, can you give us two of the main reasons that
you
could make that decision?
Repeat the question.
The question was two main reasons as to why he decided to run for council again.
Thank you.
Well, number one, I was on the council before. I took kind of a hiatus for a couple of years. Yeah, I miss it. I want to get back in and get involved in the community. And I guess that's the one main reason. I think I can bring some knowledge into it because I am aware of budgeting and how it operates and the interplay of utilities and the city and enterprising funds in the city. I've worked with it as the fire chief, and I've worked with it when I was on the council.
And that kind of leads into the second question. What is your vision for the city of North St. Paul over the next 4 years?
Well, I'll be honest. I think the next 4 years are going to be kind of rough economically. I think the city has positioned itself quite well with the properties for redevelopment. We've got a great industrial site now up on Highway 120. Granted, city lot down the old city building lot, that was kind of a shame. There was almost one ready to move in, and then the financing fell through. They are actively outdoing this. They've got the committee that's working on this, the Economic Redevelopment Committee. They have been working on it. It's just not a lot of it out there right now. Another positive thing we've had, though, with some of the properties the city has bought in residential areas, we've built four beautiful homes that have sold right away. If you've gone around and looked at the houses where the city has worked with the school district and with 916, they're building beautiful homes. It's a great education for these young people, plus it's helping increase our property values in our neighborhoods.
Thanks, Dave.
Thank you.
Is Dave Andren. He's on our Parks and Rec Commission currently.
You can use the microphone or not. I turned it off. You just have to push it.
Well, I'm pretty loud. Most people know that. So I have no problems voicing, getting my voice out there. For those who don't know me, and there's several of them out here that do, my name is Dave Andren. I'm 53 years of age. I've been married for this month, 31 years, to my wife, Mary. We have two lovely children, adult children, who now are, one of them had to move back home because of the economic times, but, you know, they're more than welcome to come back home. Currently, I'm the head engineer at Maplewood Middle School. I've been there for 9+ years. So that just that little part alone lets you know that I'm used to working with budgets. I'm also worked with most of your kids throughout my career. That's part of my job. I work with the staff there. Maplewood Middle School is one of the better schools we have in the district. Prior to that, I worked several other jobs. One of them was with the grain industry, so I know all about commodities and deadlines and all those pressure things that some of us get put under. There again, middle management almost all my life. 9.5 years I worked with the railroad. Back in 81, I was one of the first people that took out the rail line here for the Gateway Trail, which was donated from Soo Line Railroad to the DNR. Me and one of the other guys pulled probably a half a mile of rail up by hand when we first started in Stillwater and worked our way here. When I was a young boy, way back, real tiny, I was also lived on the outskirts of town here, back where there used to be the city dump. So I seen some of the trash. to get onto some of the matters at hand, I mean, I do know budgets. I've been on the Parks Commission for about 5.5 years. Presently, I am the vice chair. I work with most of the master naturalists, and I want to give my hats off to most of them. We have some in the room here that have donated hundreds of hours. Most people don't even realize what they've done for our little community. There's a few other people I want to give my hats off to, the Splash, because when a couple years ago we had some budget cuts, they stepped forward and came up with the Splash so we could get some lifeguards. in play for the beach. This is the kind of things I love about our community. One of the things that brought me and my wife and my family here is the fact that there is a good sense of community. And community is very important to me. I believe if we each take a little bit of turn and say, you know, I'll donate a Friday evening or a Saturday, pulling buckthorn or painting some playground equipment, or just helping out a neighbor next door. Those are the kind of things I grew up with, and those are the kind of things I do see in our citizens. Not everything here in North St. Paul is bad. There's a lot of good things. One of the things that we should celebrate, and I think should be out there, for instance, our town is 125 years old this year. Newman's, oldest bar, one of the oldest bars in the state of Minnesota. That's one of those things we should promote. These, I think, would help bring in more people to our town, saying, look, we have a strong history. We have a strong community. We have a strong sense of that. Unfortunately, sometimes with some of the other candidates have brought out, we do have a little lack of communication. Just recently, just earlier tonight, I did meet with Wally. He went over a few of the things. I had 9 solid questions for him. He came up and answered every one of them to my satisfaction, why we were doing certain things, and certain things are now coming into play. Unfortunately, it's Wally, our city manager, has been in play for 15 years. Part of what I see is just recently, in the last 2 years, some of the things have been coming into play. Understanding when we start new developments and stuff, it does take time for this to happen, for us to see some growth. But this is some of the things that, as our city leaders should be doing, is communicating back to our citizens. Where do we plan on seeing our city going? I see nothing but positive. Even though we've lost a lot of things over the years, our bowling alley, our hardware stores, some of this is just due to the fact that we have big box stores all around us. We have Home Depot, we have Menards, so they're one of our hardware stores. Fortunately, we still have Ace Hardware. You go down and you can buy almost anything from Ace. You can still talk to those guys. You still have that sense of community. We need to start bringing that back to downtown. And not just downtown, we also have some of our infrastructure. Our town is 125 years old. We have to realize that there are certain things in our streets, our sewer lines, either undersized or starting to crumble. We need to address those. But we need to be aware of cost and those kind of things. So I think as candidates or as council people or wherever you want to be, we should be addressing these and trying to make sure that we're going forward with this and take in mind our citizens. When they say, hey, you know, I have this issue, maybe if they have, because of economic times, we should be trying to help them through these times right now. So when we do have the good times will be good times, not where somebody is just struggling. You need a voice, that's what I want to be. I want to be your voice, so you have it both ways, not just so somebody comes in, has a little complaint, so I can bring those issues back to you. Just 2 years ago, I did run, there was a gentleman at where he lives, his house was rezoned. Because it was rezoned, he wanted to do some additional stuff to his house. He was under the impression the city was completely against him, said you couldn't put a roof on, you couldn't put new windows in, you couldn't fix up your house. It was a misunderstanding, and after I was the go-between, I explained to him he could reshingle his house. The city, when they rezoned it, didn't want this individual or any individual or in those zones to say, hey, I'm going to put a ton of money into this property and all of a sudden turn around and have it bought by the city and you have a loss. They want you to maintain your properties. I think these are good things. I think that some people don't realize we have good relationships with the watershed. It helps with our parks. These are the kind of things we want to promote. We want our parks to be good. We want our schools to be good. And our schools are starting to turn around. We had some issues a few years ago. Just recently, our math scores are coming up, our reading scores are coming up. So all of that's coming up. And it's part of us as a community, myself and everyone that's in this room and watching this, need to say, hey, It's time for us to step up. We are a community. We're all in this boat together. So that's kind of what I got for this bill.
Thanks, Dave. Okay, one of my questions for you is, what are two suggestions, and you kind of hit on it, but what are two suggestions that you would do to attract business to North St. Paul?
I think what we need to do is to attract is have advertising for the businesses that want to come in. Look, we have this great turnout every Friday night for our car show. We have, in the wintertime, we have the ice sculptures downtown. People drive from all over for that. And it, just to touch on the car show, we have people that come from Hastings. We have people that come from northern Minnesota. We even have people that come from Wisconsin just to see our cars. And let me touch on that just for a good example. I have a good friend that comes down every Friday night. He's part of the car club. But when I need him to help with one of the parks, right now I'm at Housing Park, but before a while I was with Dave Nelson over at Southwood Nature Preserve. When we needed buckthorn pole, he stepped up and said, listen, North St. Paul has always been good to me. I will donate my Saturday to come to help you. This is the same kind of attitude and stuff we need for our community, to our businesses to say, hey, this is something I want to be part of. I want to be part of this. I wanted to say, hey, this is a good area to start a business, to make one grow. We could get a name brand restaurant that would help bring in some stuff in the town. That would be great. I want to do anything that help promote bringing some new business into downtown. So we're not running over to the mall saying, okay, I'm at the mall where everything's the same. I want something that's going to be unique to our town to make North St. Paul say, hey, this is the place I want to go to.
Hey, my next question is, if you got elected, what questions will you ask yourself when you're voting on the issues that are in front of you?
My question on something like that is, I don't answer any questions like that. Is it good just for me? I want to know if it's good for every person that's out there. Is it going to help develop our town, not just downtown itself, but is it going to be good for the elderly person that's out there? Is these kind of things going to help benefit our community? It's not about me. None of this is about me. I wouldn't be doing this just for me. I want to try to help our businesses. I also want to be there for our senior citizens. A few years ago, when I was campaigning, this is just one more thing, there was an elderly lady who didn't understand the extra charge that was on her bill for the trash. And I didn't know it myself. So I went down to City Hall. I said, what is this charge? It's not a much of a charge, but to her it was a main thing. She didn't understand it. It's because we don't have the spring cleanup anymore. So if you want to call and say, hey, I have a couch I need picked up on the curb, that's what that extra charge is for. Once, and I drove back to her house, which is, you know, up on the northern part. I'm on the southern part. And I talked to her about this, and she appreciated it. I don't know if she voted for me or not, but I did answer those questions, and I'll do the same for anybody who needs those kind of questions answered. So,
Thank you very much. This is great. Candidate is Scott Thorson.
I apologize for being late. I was working my second job. So.
If you wanted to turn on the microphone.
No, I think everyone can hear me.
Okay.
My name's Scott Thorson. I am 28 years old. Looking around up here and around the room, I'm obviously probably one of the youngest people here. So I think I bring that kind of different viewpoint or different aspect to things, just my youth. I graduated from North High in 2002. I went to college at University of Wisconsin-Stout, studied business, decided that I wanted to get into accounting. So I transferred to River Falls, moved home, joined the fire department, finished school at River Falls with an accounting degree. I've been working as an accountant part-time through college and then full-time after I graduated. So I've got that business numbers aspect. I like working with numbers. I'm interested in the budget. In the years past, I've always seen that it kind of was, you know, you had to have an accounting degree to understand what the budget was about and what was going on. I noticed this year, the 2013 proposed budget, they've kind of tried to simplify things a little more. I like that. I'm all about transparency. You can, you know, I understand it, but I like to, you know, explain things so the very latent person can understand it. So I think that's something that's going in the right direction. My personal take on local government is that I think they should stick to the basic things that police, fire, public works. I think it's tempting to get involved in these other things like David mentioned before, this housing redevelopment authority that they're buying blighted homes, tearing them down, building new ones, and they're great new houses and they're selling, and that's great. But you know, I'm kind of concerned, is that really something the city should be involved in? There's risks involved with that too. I mean, they could lose money, and then we're all losing money. So I mean, it's things like that that, you know, I just kind of got me interested in running. I've spoken with a lot of my friends and family and people in town, and I kind of get that same, you know, you don't hear a lot of positive things. There's a lot of complaining and a lot of, well, why are they doing this? Why are they doing that? And I'm kind of I don't really sit back and complain. I like to do things, you know, so that's why I've decided to run. I don't really like talking about myself, so I'm going to cut it short. I'll go straight to the questions.
Thank you, Scott. First question, how do you plan to make yourself available not only to the citizens but to the businesses in the community of North St. Paul?
Well, I've already received several emails from residents, and I've responded to them in the last, you know, 5-10 minutes, as long as it takes me to type back, and they're all very shocked. Like, I was responded so quickly, but being young, I'm tech savvy. I didn't think it was that big of a deal, and if everyone's that impressed, I think I'll make everyone very happy. But I can see how there's this breakdown in communication. We see it with this bar ordinance. I think that whole thing could have been avoided with, you know, an email out to everyone laying out what the city was planning on doing, scheduling a meeting here. But, you know, that's still, we're still battling with that. They're still battling with that. So, and with the businesses, I regularly attend the business association meetings. My father, Chris Thorson, he's the president. I know quite a few business owners downtown, so I feel there's no lack of communication with them either. So.
Thank you, Scott. The second question, what are your feelings regarding the special events within the city? For an example, the car show, and I believe there were some other events that are no longer taking place in the city that were referenced earlier. How would you look at how, what are your thoughts of bringing some of that activity back to this community?
That's a great question. Obviously, I remember the car show being a little, or the crazy days and fall around a little differently, because when I was attending those, I was younger. I think they were fun and an attractive thing. It's something that small communities have, these events. They went away. I mean, I've got my opinions on why they went away, but for whatever reason, they've went away, and it takes a lot of work to put those things on. I have experience on the fire department running fundraisers. We had 2 fundraisers, and you know, everyone's got their opinion on how it should be run, but no one really wants to put the time into it to do it. So, you know, sometimes these things fade away, and it's a good thing. So if people want to see Crazy Days come back, there's nothing stopping any resident stepping up and saying, hey, I'll organize it, I'll do it. That hasn't happened. I'm not going to say I'm going to bring back Crazy Days or Fall Roundup. I think what we should do is focus on what we have now, the car show, and build on that. And I see now we've brought back the Thursday parade before that, the car show, and then that's it. I don't know if there's any consensus with businesses or any individuals that want to build on that and kind of bring stuff back, but I think there's this attitude that's grown recently that a lot of people just throw their hands down because they don't want to deal with the city. It's always know this, know that, and you know, I think that's part of the reason why you've seen things like that go away, but I'd be all supportive of bringing things like that back if there's people interested in putting the time and effort into it, and we should work with the car show people and keep that event going, because that'd be a horrible thing if they were to ever leave. I mean, there's no, I don't think you'd find one per, well, I'm sure there are a few people that maybe don't like it, but I think it's pretty consensus that that's a great thing and it should continue.
Thank you.
Thanks, Scott.